some people are waiting online. Welcome all here. Pardon me, I am on.
Are you impressed?
I am very impressed.
I am on.
You're not on.
Now I'm on. Straightened out. So 11 o'clock, here we go. The order of service has some wrong information on it because I got a text from Yako this morning at 6:30 that he is very ill, too ill to come and preach this morning. So I'm going to be doing a lot of things, including preaching this morning. So be praying. I made the font bigger, except on this bulletin. What's that? I don't have control of that. Do I? Okay, can you hear me now? Okay, so some items in the bulletin that I'll just draw your attention to. Okay, all I see, I wrote the total bigger, but our Good Friday service, of course, we take up an offering, and what we don't use for the rental and the supplies for that, we have a ministry that we give the offering to, and this year it was to the Rural Life Mission House in Thunder Bay, run by Gates and Nicole Bellieu. And the total they received from the Friday Good Friday offering was $2,196. So they are very grateful for that, and thank you for your generous hearts in giving. Missions Fest will be, I know what it is, but I was reading something else, trying to. May the 3rd, 4th, and 5th is our Missions Fest, and this year we're having the Round Lake Bible Camp directors, Brian and Susan Zietzma. They're going to come. There will be a youth night on Friday night. Then Saturday, we're going to be speaking to them on a video call on Tuesday to see what Saturday will look like. And Sunday will most likely be a regular service with them giving a presentation and me preaching, and then a potluck after the service. So that's May 3rd, 4th, and 5th, our Missions Fest. Before that, though, some of you may remember Scott Campbell, who was a church planter in Quebec through our General Conference of Canada, Baptist General Conference. And he's been there quite a few years, had some ups and downs, but he is coming April 27th. We're going to have an informal, just a coffee time and chat with Scott Campbell at Jasmine and Phillip's house, 44 McGilvery. Just some coffee and some snacks, donuts and stuff. I don't know what we're having, but just a informal chat with Scott Campbell. He has been, like I said, many years in the field, and he started a church and left it and was doing other stuff as a Baptist General Conference kind of missionary or mission kind of executive in Quebec. But he's back at the church now, as I've learned. And a few years ago, they made a documentary. His friend, who is a professional videographer, made a documentary of Scott and Nancy, his wife's life in Quebec, and all the ups and downs and that. And it's quite interesting, and it's very well done. I think it was nominated for some movie award in the States. So you can watch that before you meet him, and you'll have a better understanding of who he is and what he does, but that is April 27th. And joint Baptist hockey game. You can talk to Philip. It's May 11th, Philip or Daniel, about that. And there's a family skate after the hockey game. It's at Fort William First Nations Arena, rink number 2, May 11th. Time, 2:30 to 4:30. So anybody interested in playing hockey on the Murillo Westport team, talk to Daniel or Philip, and talk to Catherine if you want information about the family skate. It's kind of just going to be open, whoever wants to bring their skates. But the idea is everybody come to cheer on the teams at the hockey game and then go skating afterwards. So that's that. And then Women's Ministry is planning a retreat in June, so that'll be in there for a while, so you can just remember that. Let's give a call to worship. If you'd stand, please. Call to worship this morning from Psalm 9. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all of your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and exalt you in you. I will sing praises to your name, O Most High. Be gracious to me, O Lord. See my affliction from those who hate me. O you who lift me up from the gates of death, that I may recount all your praises, that in the gates of the daughters of Zion I may rejoice in your salvation.
Thank you.
Chart. He kind of looked puzzled. He opened the chart and then looked at the chart and then looked at me and then looked at the chart and kind of jumped up and said, "Wow, that's amazing." I said, "Yeah, I heal well, I'm told." And then I said, "But how is my eye?" So he looked at it and he said, "There is no sign of burning on my retina. My cataract is the same as it was, or the same as it was before we started. And so the only reason my eye is blurry is because of just some moisture, extra moisture, because there's some irritated dry spots. So it's still a little cloudy with moisture in there, but my eye is, as he is saying right now, not damaged. So that is a praise Lord item. Yeah. So when Yako, see, God just had a way. I got up earlier. Bonnie asked me, "You're going this early?" And then I got up and saw my phone message and thought, yeah, that's why I got up and I'm here early. So be praying for Yako, and Neil isn't here this morning. He's been ill the last few days, so be praying for him and all the others that are not with us because of illness. Our ministry of the month for March, no, this is April, right? Okay. So our ministry for the month of April is the young adults, and our missionary for the month of April is Don Dalva Austin in Brazil. So I think that's all. Let's go to our great God in prayer. Father, again, as we look out into this world, we see more and more unrest and tragedy and trials and troubles and sin. And we see that and we know that the time is short. So cause us to take to heart who you are and who we are. You are a holy, just God who has given undeserving sinners eternal life by your grace through faith in the life, death, and resurrection of your Son. And so you have told us that you have given us all that we need for life and godliness. We have all that we need to do your work here in Murillo. So help us to understand how precious life is, every life. And so I pray that you would lead our young adults to grow in wisdom and knowledge of their Lord and Savior, to make their decisions, the decisions they need to make as they navigate the stormy waters of this fallen world. Father, I pray, guard all our hearts. Guard the hearts of your people, our youth, our young adults, our young children, moms, dads, husbands, and wives. Help all of us to love you with all of our hearts, soul, and mind, and strength. Help us to love all others. Father, we continue to pray and minister to the sick and the hurting in our midst, in our church family here. We think of Yako and not knowing what the trouble is. Father, I pray you'd give doctors wisdom as they might look at him, and Father, for Neil as he is home and not feeling well himself. And many others, Father, we think of the strength that John and Gina need for each day, and for Randy and his lung issues. And Father, many are sick, they're hurting, they're going through trials. And Father, I pray that you would just help all of us, all of them, to trust and know that you are God and you are with them. We pray and thank you for our missionaries this month, the Austins, who have been in Brazil all of their lives, basically, Father. And we thank you that they are so thankful and praising you for the safety they had in a very long journey of over 6,000 kilometers, Father, and back to Rondônia, Father, for the ongoing translation of your word in the Gavio language, for the early steps of translation of the Bible into the Ararat language, and for that tribe of people, the Ararat people, that the church there would grow, their leaders would be strengthened and encouraged and taught and gain wisdom. Father, I pray you continue to bless Don and Delva as they continue their work there in Brazil. Father, we thank you for the Good Friday service we had. We thank you for the offering that was taken in and the money that was able to go to the Rural Life Mission House in Thunder Bay for repairs of a flooded basement. Father, you are so, so good. And I thank you for the offerings that come here to this church to meet our needs, to pay our bills and salaries and put the ministries on that we have deemed to be necessary and appropriate for what we're trying to do here in your name. So I just thank you for everything you're doing here in the life of this church, in the life of the families of this church. I just pray that no matter whether we're on cloud nine or, Father, in the depths, Father, that we would just know and trust that you are with us, you go before us, and you are all around us, and all things are working together for our good and for your glory. And so I thank you for this time that we have to honor and worship and praise your Son. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Okay, kids, I was a little late in inviting you up here to sing. So
teachers, bless them as they teach in Jesus' name.
And the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In your hand are power and might, and in your hand it is to make great and to give strength to all. And now we thank you, our God, and praise your glorious name. But who am I, what is my people, that we should be able thus to offer willingly? For all things come from you, and of your own have we given you. For we are strangers before you and sojourners as all our fathers were. Our days on the earth are like a shadow, and there is no abiding. O Lord, our God, all this abundance that we have provided for building you a house, for your holy name comes from your hand, and is all your own. I know, my God, that you test the heart and have pleasure in uprightness. In the uprightness of my heart, I have freely offered all these things, and now I have seen your people who are present here offering freely and joyously to you.
Yeah.
Well, with all of the fear and anxiety and uncertainty in this world that we live in, which I was brought face to face with this morning at 6:30 with Yako's text, but anyway, I guess I thought I didn't get, there was a gulp, but not a very big one, because I thought this all worked out with my eyes for such time as this, and I just had to make my font bigger, and I did go into the archives, and so this is a remixed message with some updates and a bit of reworking. But I've just been aware of what's going on around us, thinking about mine and Bonnie's situation right now, along with others in this church and in our community, and of course this country and this world. And I've come to think that Christians everywhere, and probably more so on this continent, in North America, need to be a little firmer in our faith. Knowing with all the uncertainty in this life, we need to be ready. We need to be more prepared for the war that we're in, and the war and the hostilities that are going to just ramp up. And it also lines up with Yako's message from a few weeks ago, in which he began, "You will die. Each and every one of you will die, myself included." So there's no guarantee that any one of us will even see tomorrow. So hence the title, If Tomorrow Comes. Now, our text this morning is found in verses 13 through 17 of James chapter 4. Let me read it for us, and then I'll pray. So James chapter 4, beginning in verse 13, James says, "Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin." Heavenly Father, we come to your word this morning, uncertain of even what will happen in the next few hours. And yet we all have plans. And so, Father, may our minds be in line with your will. We know the plans you have for us. We know our plans can come undone any moment of any day. And so I pray that we would place our trust firmly and squarely on the foundation of our faith, the Lord Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray as we look into your word this morning. Amen. So the context here in James chapter 4, in James, basically, is his concern in this letter, and his concern for us is that we would have genuine faith. Not just faith coming from expressing it with our lips. Oh yeah, of course, I believe. But a faith that is real. And he says that real faith expresses itself in action, and that's his concern in this whole letter. And in this chapter in particular, he points out for us that genuine faith works itself out in a lifestyle of humble repentance before God. And what James will show us is that the only solution to the uncertainty of life and the problem of sin is to trust in the sovereign grace of a holy God. And so the first thing that James does is to point out how we can't know with any certainty just how our life will unfold or how long or short our life will be. So the first thing to think about is the uncertainty of this life. And I see this problem James addresses here 2,000 years ago isn't really all that different from what we struggle with today. James is talking to wealthy businessmen here who were acting and living as though God didn't matter. They were acting and living as if whatever we plan to do is going to get done. And what they were doing was presuming upon God, presuming that their plans would certainly come to fruition. And today we can easily do the same thing. We plan and we chase after our goals and our dreams and our desires. And hear me, don't think James is saying don't plan. We want to plan, or we'll get to that in a bit, but we believers can go through days, even weeks, until we suddenly realize that we haven't prayed about any of our plans. We haven't brought our plans before God. And James is bringing us back to reality here. He's reminding us that life is not ours to do with as we please. He's saying we can go on and live as fundamental atheists in our day-to-day lives, living like there is no God over and above our plans. And he basically says something that hit me at the heart. And Yako did that in his opening sentence a few weeks ago, but we are going to die. All of us are going to die, and in the whole scheme of things, our life on this earth is very short. What is your life, James says? It's a mist that appears for a short time, and then poof, it is gone. I remember the day that super healthy Anthony, actually I never was super, I guess pretty is more like it. So pretty healthy Anthony used to rise at the crack of dawn, not wanting to miss the best part of the day. I loved being up before the sun was all the way up and be reading my Bible right then. Some summer mornings there was a little chill in the air and there's this low-lying mist over the ground. But within a few short minutes, you look out the window and the mist is gone. It's burnt off by the quickly rising sun. It's there 1 minute and gone the next. And James says, our lives are like that mist. We are here 1 minute and gone the next. Life is uncertain. And that uncertainty of life troubles us. With all the modern technology we have, and we think of all the science and the doctors and all that we have that are available to us, great, good, meaning, well-meaning doctors and scientists like the ones I had who were setting my radiation treatments up. I had a medical nuclear physicist, along with the radiation oncologist, along with the radiation technicians, all making their best attempts to have the machine set at the exact angle to produce the best results and do the least amount of harm. But we have people with skills and abilities in these days we live beyond imagination, and still we get sick and we eventually die. I will die. Even after all the healing that has been done through the years, I will die. And you will die one day as well. History tells us of a famous city, or infamous city, however you want to look at it, Constantinople. When the man that was going to be crowned as emperor was to be installed, the royal stonemason would bring slabs of marble to him on his coronation day. The emperor himself would pick out his gravestone from those marble slabs. Kent Hughes, in his commentary on James, says, the ancients thought it was wise for the emperor to remember his funeral at the time of his elevation, for his life would not last forever. Now, not to be morbid, but what if our culture practiced that at our high school or university graduations? After all the speeches about being anything you want to be, doing anything you want to do, now here, pick out your gravestone. Might bring a sense of reality to life, that our life here is not guaranteed to last, and we should recognize that it belongs to God alone to unfold before us. Bonnie and I were looking at some yearbooks the other day. We're reminiscing because I'm putting a lot of old VHS tapes to digital before the tapes just disintegrate. But I pulled out the yearbook and I was looking, and you see these pictures and these faces from our past. Some of them we still see. Some of them, a lot of them in our class, were dead and gone before they were 30 years old. And that's life. We live in a culture and in a context where we do our best not to face the grim reality that this time next week, the people we're here with today might be rearranging their schedules to attend our funeral, or we theirs. And James is reminding us it can happen that fast and often without any notice. What is your life? God, through James here this morning, tells us that it is uncertain and very short, even if we live to a ripe old age. And I just say some fruits ripen quicker than others, but you see a banana on my microwave that turns brown in 2 days and then is gone. But even if we live a full life, I think a lot of us know the older you get, you quickly realize how fast it goes and how short it is, filled with trouble and uncertainty. So James gives a warning against presuming long life, a warning against presumption. So he goes on to say in verse 15, instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. Verse 16, as it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. James doesn't mince words. He says, if we live this way, if we are presuming upon God, if we say we can do as we please and we'll make our plans, thinking nothing will thwart them, having no thought of God, taking no thought to pray, taking no thought to seek his guidance or will. If that's how we live as practical atheists. And he says, we boast about our life. And we all do it. We're all boasters in something. Paul tells us that when he says, God forbid that I should boast, save in the cross of Christ. The prophet Jeremiah before him said, let him who boasts boast in this, that he knows me, says the Lord. We all boast in one or two things, or one of two things. And so here's a question to ask ourselves. What do you reassure yourself with when you're insecure? When you walk into a room, you feel insecure and you wonder, am I going to measure up to these people? What do these people think of me? What do you reassure yourself with? Whatever it is, that's what you're boasting in. Do you reassure yourself by saying, I'm pretty good looking? If I just had another eyebrow? I've got a good bank account. I live on the right side of the tracks. I drive the right car. That's our boast. I had a coworker way back at the mill that was blown away when I sold my Jeep and bought a minivan. He was disgusted with me. He said, how could you sell a Jeep? And he blamed my wife for talking me into giving up my manhood. And I said, it was actually my idea, so that me and the deacons could travel together down to conferences. My identity wasn't in my Jeep. My identity is in Jesus. Whatever we reassure ourselves with, James says, when we boast in what we have, when we make much of ourselves and much of what we've done, and we make much of our plans and leave God out of all of it, James says it's boasting, and that boasting, he says, is evil. He used a pretty strong word there to let us know just how wrong and how ungodly it is to boast in our life and in our possessions and our plans rather than boasting in the Lord. So in regards to our plans, he next shows us how we're under the illusion that we're in control. We have an illusion that we're in control of it all. In verse 15, he gives us this big instead. Hey, I'm going to do this and that and make this much and sell this much. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills. Death shatters the illusion that we control our lives. Death is the great equalizer. It's the great reminder that what James is saying is true. But when we come to realize that, uncertainty can give us, it can grip us, it can paralyze us. And this kind of uncertainty creates and fuels much of the anxiety we have and see in this world around us today. We do our best to get rid of it, and there are usually two common strategies. The first is trying to gain more control. In our culture, one of the things people like to hold high is how in control of their lives they are. And you think about the advertising you've seen this week. It's all about having more control of your life through an app, through a diet, through a home security system, through better banking and investing. And the great reality is that we can have all of those apps. We can have the best security system. We can have the strictest exercise program, the best investment strategy and investment tools, and we will still suffer loss. We will still suffer anxiety over health and relationships and money, and we will suffer death. But we're always trying to get control. That's one way we try to deal with the anxiety. The other way we try to get rid of our uncertainty and anxiety is to self-medicate. And maybe it's dieting. Maybe it's buying stuff. When you get depressed, maybe you feel that life's uncertain, things are out of control. You might seek control by clicking the Buy Now button on Amazon. That's what makes you feel good and powerful and in control. And of course, it might be drugs or alcohol. But whatever it is, when the uncertainty of life really starts to hit us, we can be filled with fear and it can paralyze us. People will resort to almost anything to keep or to gain control. But it's only an illusion of control. Let's look at one little word in our fourth point I have down here is that this word fuels, or what it is that fuels our anxiety. The fuel of our anxiety. See, everything about uncertainty, everything in our lives that fuels this anxiety hinges on our view of these two little letters that we see in our text. IF. If. That's what fuels our anxiety. What if? How many what ifs have cost you sleep this week? How many decisions do we make based on the what ifs? If changes everything. If only. If I hadn't. If I had. If. What if? According to James, the cure for uncertainty seems to be the very reason for it. If. But it's what follows that makes all the difference. He says, what you ought to say is, if the Lord wills, we will do this and that. In other words, every if of your life and of mine is in God's hands. James is focusing our attention on the fact that God is sovereign over everything. That when we make our plans, the correct posture for us to take, as he's talking to us about the greatness of God and our inherent weakness as frail creatures, the best posture for us to take is to not say if and then be terrified. It's to say with the utmost confidence, if the Lord wills, we will all be here together next Sunday. If the Lord wills, I'll wake up tomorrow morning. If the Lord wills, we'll take another breath. The only if that matters is the if that James tells us about here in James chapter 4. The God of the Bible is the God of the ifs. Every if is in his hands, and you can trust him. Time won't permit me to go all the texts that list that in the scripture, but know that the uncertainty of life doesn't have to paralyze us, doesn't have to make you crumble, doesn't have to lead you to more self-medication. It shouldn't lead us to less prayer, less Jesus, less Bible. No, James says, if you say this, if you understand this, this if changes everything and rids us of the fear and uncertainty in our future. If the Lord wills, and we'll see, it's the Lord that we can trust. And we have verse 17 hanging here kind of out of the blue. So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin. Jesus turns our attention then to the sin of neglect. The sin of neglect. Is this just James randomly throwing thoughts out there, totally unorganized? I don't think so. I think what he's doing here is giving us a summary of what's come before and a bridge to the next section, which we're not going through the whole book. So it's a summary in the sense of that James is telling us what the main problem that he's been focusing on for the past 16 verses and what it really is. He's been showing us our sins of omission. The Bible gives us two different kinds of sin. There are sins of commission, things that we do that God commands us not to do, and there are sins of omission, the things that God has commanded us to do that we fail to do. That's what James is dealing with here. But as my only point under this, I can say that there are no excuses. When my parents were planning on getting my sister a horse, and that's a whole different story I can go on for, but there's a whole pile of stuff with that. But let's get a horse. It's easy to say. Yeah, let's get a horse. I didn't really like that period of my life, but on this point, to prepare for a horse, there are some things you need to do. We needed to clear some wooded areas to make a bigger pasture. So my dad felled all the trees. They were all poplar, and back in the day you could sell poplar to the mill and would get more per cord if it was peeled. So my dad said that he would pay me and my sister, who wanted the horse so much, but he would pay us so much per tree. But he put a time limit on when they all needed to be peeled, because he had a truck that was going to come and take them away on a certain day. So we actually had all summer. And he had figured out how many trees per day we'd need to peel. And if we didn't meet our quota, we'd be docked pay when the money came in. So what a summer. Anyway, didn't matter to him how long it took us to get our daily quota done. If we finished by noon, we had the day to do whatever we want. If we were working at it till 10 p.m., that's fine. He just set a quota for each day. That's what he expected us to do. We could never plead ignorance and say, Dad, we didn't know we had to do that many. And I think it was only like three or something, so it wasn't child slave labor or anything. But that's James' point here. We can never look to God and say, Father, I didn't know. He says, whoever knows the right thing. So you've learned what God thinks about certain things. And you know that whoever knows this right thing to do. And so what has he been talking about throughout this chapter? Worldliness and pride. So we know that pride is wrong. We know that worldliness is wrong. We know that these things that he's been describing here are things that are wrong, things that as people of God we're not supposed to be doing, but we do. And so that raises the question, is there any hope for weak people who fail like us? Why does James put this statement in here? Well, I'll make it a main point. It shows us our complete dependence on him. We are completely dependent on the sovereign grace of a sovereign, holy God. This is James' concern. It's why he's writing and reminding the people of God then, the people of God throughout the ages, and the people who are professing faith in the Lord Jesus today. That is first that we are undone before God. We have no hope in and of ourselves to do these things. Whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, it is sin. And I don't know, maybe it is, maybe it isn't a true picture of your life and or mine over the past week. We fail time and time again. We all do. And so is there any hope for failing people? And we say, yes, amen, there is. But the way for us to have that hope, experience the peace that goes with that hope, that he is so concerned for us to experience, is a way that looks strange to a dying, frustrated, anxious, and watching world. The way to hope is first to admit our helplessness, to admit your hopelessness. It's one of the scandals of the message of the gospel. You and I are helpless and hopeless, and recognizing that we're in that position destroys the illusion of control that we all so desperately crave and are so desperately trying to keep or to gain. When it comes down to it, what James is saying is this: your life is a mist, and you don't have control of it. Why? Because we are helpless, hopeless sinners. We know what we're supposed to do, and we fail again and again and again, and we don't do what our Father tells us we're supposed to do, supposed to be doing. And that's where each and every person has to start. When we stand and sing about the glory and the sovereignty and the holiness of the amazing grace of God on a Sunday morning, none of that glory and sovereignty and grace will make any sense to any of us until our eyes are open to see where we start from, to realize our true nature, the real situation that we find ourselves in as frail creatures of the dust, like mist that rises every morning. That's the starting point as we humbly repent and trust in the Savior's sacrifice for not being able to live perfectly on our own. That's the place to start in receiving God's amazing grace. And so what that does, secondly, is it brings an end to our excuses. The simple question is, have you seen your need to come before the cross of Christ in humble repentance? And it's not just for the unbeliever. James is talking to believers here. Repentance is for all people, saved and unsaved. The only thing it's going to cost is our pride. Often when our conscience is pricked, we see our sin and we see that what we do is often so contrary to God's will, but we'll still try to dodge admitting that we're in the wrong. I've never been to law school. I'm not a lawyer, but in my own mind, I think I'm a pretty good one. A defense attorney anyway, I'm the best defense lawyer I have for my sin. I can give every excuse imaginable to rationalize and to try and justify any number of sins I commit or omit. My best guess is that we're scared to get to the end of our excuses because we're afraid of who we are. We're scared of who we'll find at the end of our excuses. But listen to this. The reality and the goodness of the gospel is that the God that we find at the end of our excuses is the one who's been drawing us to himself the whole time with open arms. That's the beauty. You don't have to be afraid to get to the end of your excuses because the God you find there is the God of grace who says, do not worry. Do not be anxious for anything. I've got you and I love you and I've paid for those sins, committed or omitted. And so what we learn is that God is God and we are not God. So what do we do with this? There's a couple of things to get practical here. In saying that we shouldn't presume anything and plan, I need to say, of course, we should plan. It's not wrong for us to plan and to dream and to look ahead. But this text tells us that we should plan well. One of the problems we have in our modern life planning is our schedules. We can be dominated by them, where we just give up, overwhelmed, feeling down, and don't do any of the things we plan when we reach that point of discouragement. Or maybe the schedule is so busy that we seemingly don't even have time to check what's next and just kind of fly through our days by the seat of our pants, and whatever comes, or as I've done a few times, miss some appointments. And of course, there is one appointment we won't miss. But we can also be so set and determined on our schedule that, Lord, help us if anybody else help me and anybody else who messes with the Almighty schedule. We all plan. We all follow our plans in one way or another. The problem is not that we plan. It's how we plan. And we need to plan well, and do we plan well? There are two keys to planning well. And first of all is to remember who you are. When we all sit down with our calendar, realize that that calendar could be null and void at any time. You might not be here to see the plans you've made on April the 8th, or on June 24th. Those appointments on Tuesday might not be kept. That has to be your starting point. That's a starting point, but don't stop there, because if you stop there, if you say, well, that's great, thanks, I'm really encouraged now. I'm actually more uncertain and more anxious, because now all I'm going to do is look at this stupid calendar on my phone and go, I'm going to die. What's the point? But that's not what James is saying. He's saying, remember who you are when you plan. Remember that you're not God and you're not over all things. Proverbs has a lot to say about planning, that we plan wisely, as Proverbs 69 says, but he tells us, man plans in his heart. So yes, plan. Just remember, though, that it is the Lord who directs your steps. So secondly, then, we need to remember the one who directs our steps. Remember who God is. Realize that you can be the busiest person on the face of the planet, and when God's appointed time comes, it will all end. Having that perspective, James says, frees you from the slavery to the schedule. It frees you to plan well, because you know who you are and you know who God is. He says, no matter what happens to your plans, trust God. God says, trust me, I've got the plan, and it's my plan for you, and it is good. It's like I mark my schedule in pencil, knowing it could drastically change. But God uses a pen, and his plan for us is in permanent ink. A story I've told many times, but it's timeless, and I was in a pinch this morning for sermon illustration, so I think some of you heard it just the other night, but I asked Bonnie to marry me before we even went out together. We were in high school. We ended up together with some mutual friends at their house one night, and I whipped out my 8.5 by 11 hand-drawn plans of the house I was planning to build on the property my parents were giving me. And I asked her if she liked the plan, and she asked me why she had to like it. It was my house, and I told her that it was because that she would be living there one day. I had confidence in my plan. But lesson one, guys, make your intentions known before you lead a girl too far in a relationship. But anyway, several things happened in between. But it turns out that the Lord willed that she be my wife. And my house plans never came to be. We built a house, all right, but I wasn't the designer. I just put everything in that house that we thought would be neat. In my plans, everything that I thought would be neat and necessary. But I think what I'm saying is that the blueprint for your life will not necessarily look like the plans you've drawn in pencil on that little 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper. And that's okay. The Father says, trust me. You would do exactly what I'm doing if you knew what I know. That's what God is telling us. God loves us too much to give us any illusion that we're ultimately in control. He's God, he's in control. And all that he wills, all that he decrees, all that he allows to come into our life, your life, is for your good. That's his promise. Do you believe it? Recognize who you are and recognize who God your Father is. And that takes us really to what I see as the heart of this text. And I want to propose that James is bringing out the point that the Lord who wills is the Lord who has died. Some commentators in history have said that there's not a whole lot of gospel in James, and most famously it was Martin Luther who called this a right straw-y epistle. He didn't think it should be part of the canon of Scripture. And some today still say, well, there's not a real high teaching of Jesus here. And yet, think about what James has told us. When you look back in chapter 2, verse 1, he says that Jesus is the Lord of glory. Here he says, if the Lord wills. That Lord title is the most common title for Jesus. God's Son. In all of the New Testament, and I think what James is saying here, is when he tells us it's the Lord who wills, he's telling us that the Lord who wills is the Lord Jesus who dies. The Lord who wills is the same Lord who died for us, for our sin, and was raised to life that we might have life. That changes everything. When we think about the Bible's teaching on God's sovereignty, he's over everything from ruling over the planets and stars in the far reaches of the universe down to every detail of our lives, even the amount of eyebrow we have or lack of it. If his sovereignty, no, not if, his sovereignty is complete in scope. It's inexhaustible in its vastness. It is fixed. God has planned everything from beginning to end. That's the message on every page of the Bible. If the Lord wills. But if you just stop there, if you just have the Lord who wills, and that's what you've got in your mind when you think God, and you think God isn't a God of love, but a God who simply dictates everything, James adjusts our vision here. He takes the font up to a few sizes like I have in the manuscript that I still can't see very well. But the same time the Bible tells us about this sovereign God, it tells us that this sovereign God desires to save people and plans all their circumstances for their good and for his glory. I think we're all looking forward to the day when we stand before God, maybe a little fearful, but we actually stand in the righteousness of Jesus before a holy God, and we can look back over our entire life. And what we'll see in all of the tangled threads of our life, all of the sin, all of the hurt, all of the failure, all of the unfulfilled dreams and disappointments, all those things, like your great house plans that you had to give up, all the times you said, I never imagined it would turn out like this, or this would turn this way. And you look back over all that and you see glory written all across it. God's glory magnified in every aspect of your life, and you stand there in eternity because the God who wills is the God who died, the Lord who died for you and I on a cross and took our punishment on himself, that we can stand before him in heaven. That's the price paid so you can give up control and have peace. And here's the deal. If you want your life to be truly under control, the Bible, the gospel tells you, you have to give up control. You have to stop striving for and grasping after control and realize the truth that you were never really in control anyway. And as the gospel invites us to do that, it also invites us to give up the illusion of control that causes us heartburn and ulcers and sleepless nights and stress and heart attacks and strained relationships. And as we give that up, as God invites us to trust him completely, it's then you'll realize who's in control and what true control is. And we'll realize it never rests with us. Absolutely. We have a part to play. We are responsible to respond, but in the whole scheme of things, it rests with the one who willed his son to die to pay the price of our sin. It rests with the one whose will for our lives is good, and his will is that we will be with him forever. And when we see what he sees, we'll do what he asks of us because that's our new desire. That's what he tells us. Years ago, that young man with the house plans got the wife of his dreams. Didn't get that particular house, but he got one with a few other wonderful homes along the way thrown in, but homes to raise our two boys in who are now out and on their own building their homes. But as I dreamed and planned, and then as we dreamed and planned, nowhere did we plan on spending 35 years in and out of hospitals for one illness after another, for either of us or both of us. we actually were both in the hospital at the same time. We've planned a lot of things over the years. And absolutely, some things we planned poorly. We thought they were okay plans, good plans. Some things, I think, along the way, we have planned well. All to say that we've had to adjust our plans many a time because God, in his wisdom, had other plans for us. And he ordained and ordered and allowed and used all those things, all the things that we've been through thus far in our short and finite life, all of them were for our good and for his glory. And I wouldn't change a thing. We don't always, in fact, we seldom really know what exactly God is up to. But what James tells us is that when we know the Lord of all of our ifs, that's what matters most, because we can be absolutely certain that we can trust his plans for us. Nothing will thwart his plans to conform you to the image of his Son and bring you home to glory one day. He is the author and the perfecter of our faith. Let's pray. Father, I pray that we would all believe what James is telling us. We believe, but oh Father, help our unbelief and help us truly believe that you are doing us good, not only in the bright and sunny days, but even when we're under the storm clouds of life. Let us cling to the truth of your absolute sovereignty, your control over our lives as we plan as best as we can according to your will, because you love us and you sent your Son to die for us. And it's in Christ's precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you. And now may God shine his face upon you. May he lift his countenance upon you and give you peace as we leave this place. Amen.